guys on quite an interesting KD topic. So the title of my KD topic is going to be actually things to note before deploying your app to the Google Play Store and the Apple Play Store. Now, as you all are aware, and the Google Play Store is used for deploying Android apps, the Apple Play Store is mostly used for deploying iOS apps. But one thing that you guys have to know is that despite the fact that there are a few differences in procedures that you have to follow by trying to deploy an app, one thing that you guys have to take into consideration is that the procedures or the important factors or features that you need to be aware of before you deploy any kind of app to these two stores always have to stay the same. Okay, so without further ado, I'm going to start listing and explaining all the important factors that you need to note before deploying your app to Google or Apple Store. Okay, so now the first and kind of the most important thing that you have to note is, are you actually ready for the Google Play Store? I mean, if you're ready to publish, you should take a look at their guidelines. Because so for this one, I'm actually going to put more of an emphasis on the Google Play Store. But just like I said there on before, it's basically the same thing. It's kind of almost the same procedures and factors that you need to take into consideration when trying to also deploy for the Apple Store. So now, if you're ready to publish, you should take a look at the Google Play guide to making high quality apps. Make sure that your app or game meets core quality standards. And thereby, the main reason for this is to reduce any friction later part of the publishing process. So if you feel like you aren't yet ready to actually deploy an app to a Play Store, then there is no need to even start trying, because you're just gonna have many issues at the end of the day and find that it's not even worth it, so to speak. Then number two, target the right audience. So it is very, very important to get your app or game into the hands of your desired audience. And an example of this is the content rating system in a Google Play application. For example, when you look at movies, you realize that there's movies and games, you've got adult rated content, you've got 17 plus, 14 plus and stuff like that. So basically, you know, this movie is meant for only adults, this movie is meant for only kids, and this movie is meant for everyone, so to speak. So if you are able to target a particular or the right audience for your app, it's actually going to enable you to gain more downloads and better ratings overall for your app. And where in the world are your users? Now, when you are building an app or a game to the Play Store, you need to consider early on if you are going to distribute internationally or even worldwide. It might not seem like a high priority, but you should decide early on, because where you choose to distribute can have some knock-on effects. For example, you might need localized resources. You have to write a localized app description. There may be different legal requirements depending on the territory you target. For example, deploying an app that is primarily going to be used by the Chinese is actually going to be very, very different from deploying an app that is primarily meant to be used by the Americans. There are lots of legal loopholes and legal terms and issues that you have to take note of. And this is highly, very, very, very important. I have to take note of when trying to deploy an app. Then you can also adapt your app for time zone changes, different currencies, etc. So data relevant materials for Android polishing. So there are a few things you need to have organized before you begin publishing your app. So it will make life a lot easier for you to gather all these materials before you start the nitty-gritty part of preparing to publish on the Google Play Store. Then get your cryptographic keys. So now, a cryptographic key allows you to provide a digital signature that authenticates your apps or games. So this digital signature is more of like a way of knowing if that content that your digital content, be it let's say an email, a media such as video or pictures, is actually your own. So it is something very, very important. And the reason why it is that important is that it helps to avoid copyright issues and fraudulent activities, so to speak. So you should use the same cryptographic key for the lifespan of your apps. And this is very, very important. In fact, if after uploading an app on your Google Play Store account for the very, very first time, if you actually try to, or if you create an update of that app, but you build that app with a different cryptographic key, there is no way you'll be able to upload the new version of the app because Google Play won't allow you. Because what Google Play does is that they have this software that goes through your app, the APK file they're trying to upload, and looks at the cryptographic keys and ensure that, so this software ensures that the previous version and the cryptographic keys for the previous version and that of the newer version actually matches. So if they don't, there's no way they're going to allow you to upload that your new APK file because it's assumed that you are not the correct owner of that app. So this is a requirement for everyone publishing on the Google Play and also and allows users to upgrade their apps with ease. It is very, very important to keep your cryptographic keys secure. You need to make sure no one can access these keys and compromise your user security. Keeping these keys secure is relatively easy if you follow these steps. So use a strong password for your key store and keys. So, and this is one thing for mobile app developers. For mobile app developer, you realize that one of the most important parts of your app is actually the key store. And why? Because the key store, like as the name denotes, contains the most important information about your app. It contains app name, contains the name of the organization that builds the app, contains the country the app was built in, contains a secret password for that app, which is going to allow you to be able to upload the app on the Play Store and a host of other info. So don't allow anyone else to access your key or to know your key store or key password, and keep your key store file in a secure place. Also highly, highly important. Then design your application icon, obviously, because like every organization, every company needs a peculiar icon that differentiates them from the rest. And applications are also the same thing. All applications should have a logo that separates them from the rest. And apart from this logo also enables them, it gives them like, this logo gives your app something like a brand identity. It makes it easier for people to actually recognize your app, especially if they're looking for your app in the Play Store and that stuff. So when it comes to designing your icon, simplicity is key. There are a few rules that will help you design a great icon. Avoid using words, choose one visual element, use the correct format and size, and also be creative. Don't be afraid to get creative and make something that will stand out from the crowd. There are rules of thumb to follow, but that doesn't mean you can't think outside the box. Okay, then after that, write your end user license agreement. Now this is also another very, very, very important thing that you have to, another very, very important fact that you have to know, because an end user agreement or EULA, I love calling it EULA, or some actually say EULA, are the terms and conditions that you set for using your app or game. You should include a EULA with your app or game so that it is used for purposes that you intend. So this is like you could say the disclaimer by telling them that okay, this is what this app is meant to use. It's meant to be used for. Be aware of these legal conditions that are in this app. So basically, it's kind of like legal terms and conditions that covers you in case of anything. For example, if someone decides to use your app in a way that it wasn't meant to in the beginning, and something happens to them, when the person tries to sue you, you are covered because. And you won't be affected because everything is stated in your end user license agreement. So prepare your marketing materials. So once you publish your app or game, you need some users. You need to get some users. Something you need to know about Google Play Store is that Your app store page will be the first impression most people have on your app or game. So it's important to look good. App store optimization means having the best marketing materials and tailoring them to for Google Play. So one thing about marketing is everywhere. Marketing is something that as developers we have to acknowledge that it's very, very, very important for whatever app that we are using, we are building. And the reason for this is that it doesn't make sense you spend lots of hours building an app or building a piece of software. At the end of the day, you realize that you aren't even able to get it out there to your end users. Why? Because you don't have a good marketing strategy. And that is very, very interesting, because at the end of the day, you realize that, okay, that piece of software you built, you can't make money from it, because since you don't have a proper marketing strategy, not many, like a lot of people do not even have any idea of the app. And even if they have, don't even know what the app is meant to do. So marketing is kind of a very, very good and solid sound way to create awareness or promote awareness about the app and its features. Now, plan your monetization strategy. So most developers will plan to make some money back on the apps or games release. There are a few decisions to make about your monetization strategy before publishing on Google Play. The first issue is whether your app or game will be paid or free. If you decide to take the paid option, you can still change your mind later and make your app or game free, but never change it back. However, if you publish your app or game for free, it must always remain free. And this is something that I find a whole lot of companies defaulting on. But well, looking at the present economic situations, it's not really their fault. So the thing is that, for example, when you see all these annoying apps, most of us, we see them as annoying. You download the app and it's active. For every page you go to, there's an ad. So the issue is that now they made the app free, but in order for them to be able to make some sort of money from the app, they are now adding ads to the app and stuff so that they can actually make some sort of money. So there are a few routes you could go to. I mean, you can go for the paid routes. So once it's paid, you know that there's no need to add ads to your app, or you could go for the free one. So most times, what apps normally do is that they offer two versions of this app. And the first version is going to be a free version, but this version now has a lot of ads. Then if you now decide that you don't want the ads, you can now pay a certain amount of money that will now unlock the paid version for you. And once you now upgrade to that paid version, you will never see any ads again. So with both options, you can take advantage of in-app billing services to monetize your app or game by providing in-app purchases or subscriptions. So in-app billing is kind of a way of, for example, a lot of games use this system. So you download the game and the game is free, for example. And but within the game, there are other things, other stuff within the game that you can actually buy for free. It's just like if you are playing a game and they tell you, okay, you need to get more tokens, you need to buy it and stuff like that. Then luckily, there is a cross-platform in-app purchase plugin available from Felgo. So Felgo is actually a sort of app development corporation that you can use on both Google Play and iTunes Store without charging a single line of code. If you are going to go to paid app or game routes, it's important to consider the following. Selling apps in multiple currencies, prices and split currencies, transaction fees, and specifying tax rates. So all these are a couple of things that you have to definitely consider. Then pick a suitable package name. So a package name, or as some people might call it, an app ID. For example, you can normally find it in your config.xml file, and it's a name that you actually set while building an app for the first time. So it uniquely identifies it on users' devices and the Play Store. So all the apps on the Google Play Store have to have specific package names. Two apps cannot have the same package name, it's not possible. So there is normally a template on how you can be able to create these package names. So choosing a good package name means picking something that will be suitable for the entire duration of the app's lifespan. You must use lowercase letter. You can use uppercase and lowercase letters from A to Z, and that's called your package name. Although individual package names must start with a letter. So, for example, you can see example of a package name can be com.example.weather.app. So that's just like an example of a package name. Then turn off login and deploy login. So during the app development process, it's normally very, very, very important to add login and debugging. Now, and the reason for this is that it actually helps you to test your app during the development phase and ensure that all variables are working, all features are working as they should be. But then it is heavily frowned upon that you should publish a production-ready app and leave login and debugging turned on. It's not right because you are exposing your app to malicious users, for example. And this can actually inspect your app, and through the login and debugging endpoints that you left on, they can actually be able to know what your app is all about and secret info that you do not want to actually leave to go out there. So you have to make sure that before you actually build your app that you have turned off login and debugging. Then review and update your manifest and Gradle build settings. So in this one, you also have to, every Google application needs an Android manifest.xml. Now, normally for the first time when you're trying to create the project for your app, it's automatically added. But later on, before you actually upload to the Play Store, you have to ensure that you have reviewed it to make sure that there are no errors whatsoever. So there are three main parts of the manifest that you need to check. The user uses permission element. So user permission is kind of like all these app permissions, for example, camera permission, location and location permission and stuff like that. So you should only specify permissions that are relevant and required for your application. Then Android icon and Android label attributes. You must specify values of these attributes which are located in the application elements. Then Android version code and Android version name attributes. So it is recommended that you specify values for all these attributes which are located in the manifest and element. For more information on these steps, you can check the link below. Then address compatibility options. So your app needs to be compatible on a number of different devices. There are a few things that you need to consider when testing for compatibility, such as multiple screen sizes and tablets. So for example, when you're building an app, you have to ensure that, can that app run on Android 4.0? Can it run on Android 5.0? Can it run on 6.0, 7.0, 8.0, 9.0? So it's something that you have to be aware of. And then if you feel that your app is not backwards compatible, so from which particular Android version, for example, is it backwards compatible to? For example, most apps nowadays start from Android 5.0 in terms of compatibility from 5.0 to 9.0. So because gradually you see that, you notice that less and less phones are actually using Android 4.4.4 and below. So they're now dropping compatibility options for those. Then update URLs for servers and services. Now this is actually important because normally it is always advisable that when you are during the development process of an app, you actually have like two servers. The first server is for testing and the second server is for the live server, the main server. So basically, the test server is kind of like a sandbox where you test your features, make sure everything is working properly. And the reason for this is that it avoids you transferring any errors or creating any errors on the live server. So for example, if you are trying to integrate a new feature, all you have to do is you test that new feature on the test server, and if it's working properly, you just copy and paste or transfer the feature into the live server and so forth. Then about Google Play and licensing. So if you want to release a paid app on Google Play, then you should definitely consider licensing for Google Play. Licensing allows you to control who accesses your paid app. And while this isn't an essential step for everyone, it is highly recommended by Google Play. Then confirm your app for game size. Now, most apps actually are below 50 MB. From time to time, you will see that odd app, maybe it's a game, for example. For example, Assault 8 is around 1.0 gig. But then the issue now is that there is a 100 MB size limit for APKs when publishing on Google Play. So if your app exceeds this limit, you can always take advantage of what we call APK expansion files. However, unless your app is much larger than 100 MB limits, you might be better off reducing the size of your app to meet the normal size. So basically, what is APK expansion files is that they kind of allow you to bundle, to just you upload a smaller version of your app first. So this smaller version, for example, if you look at the game Asphalt 8, initial download is like, let's say 80 something MB, I can't remember, I know it's thereabout. Then for downloading it, when you now install it and you now initialize app for the very first time, the app now connects directly to their own server to now get all the remaining expansion files. And so these are what we now know as APK expansion files. Then localization and the Play Store. Localization is also very important because, I mean, for an app that's on the Play Store is virtually in every country, like is accessible from almost every country in the world. And, you know, it's going to be across different time zones, different languages. And so you also have to ensure that you have enabled internationalization and localization. So if you've completed all the steps so far, including the decision of where to launch, then you are ready to localize your app again. Localizing involves translating everything about your app so it is suitable for international markets. Unfortunately, there is no free service that can do this for you. And while you could use online translators, a professional translator is always recommended for accuracy. And it is not just the text of your app that you need to consider doing. You should also localize your app store page and any marketing material that uses text. So once you localize your app again, it's also important to test it to make sure that everything works as before. For all details on localization, please check out the Google Play localization checklist. Okay, upload and test the Play Store version of your app. So if you've completed all the previous steps, you should be all set to upload your APK to your Google Play Developer Console and start testing. The first thing you should do is follow these basic steps to test your recently released APK. Now, how to publish an app with app optimization. Now that your app is ready to publish on Google Play, it's time to optimize your App Store page. If you've already gotten your icon and promotional materials ready, here are a few more tips to help you get your strategy right. Make sure you put your app or game in the correct category. Write a good description for your app. So basically, a good description can be something that like what your app is all about. Because people who are going to the place to download this particular app are going to check out the app description. So it should be something about a brief explanation of what your app is all about and the features of your app, something like that. So analyze and tweak the Play Store page as you go. Then 20, final checks and publishing. So before you hit publish on Google Play Developer Console, you should do some final checks. Make sure that your developer profile has all the correct info and is linked to the correct Google Payments merchant account. You uploaded the correct APK version, the Play Store page is optimized, you've set the correct pricing options, you've set your country's targeting and price accordingly, you've listed the correct compatible devices, and the correct support email address and websites are linked, your app or game doesn't break any Google Play rules, and you've acknowledged that your app meets the guidelines for Android users on the Play Store and US report laws. Then you are now ready to launch. So after that, once you finish using all these final checks, you can now head over there, click on publish, and your app is set. So this is the end of this KD for today, and I hope that with these few points, I've been able, or if for is you don't actually need to be a developer to know all this, it's just something that you should be able to have at the back of your mind for future purposes, because like they always say, no knowledge is wasted, and you can never know when you are going to need this, especially non-techies. So thank you all once again for listening, and once again, my name remains Okoye Onyekachi. Thank you very much.